I'd like to welcome any visitors that we might have here this morning. Be sure that you sign the registries over in the back, if you would, please. So let us know that you were here. And I have one additional announcement above those that are in the bulletin. Several people have asked Jan, after she played, could you give us the words or tell us the titles of the songs that you're playing? Because they really sound familiar, but my old brain just don't register what they are. So she has written the song, the words out. There's a sheet laying in the back. If you would like to pick it up, she'll have a couple copies back there every week. And you can pick it up and refresh your memory then today. And then next week you can follow along as she's playing. Then I have Mike has an announcement he would like to make.
Just as a reminder, next Saturday, we're going to have the Still Carry course here at the church. We held it at the fellowship hall. It is going to start at 9 o'clock sharp. So be here a little bit early so you can get here and thank the gentleman for doing the course. The cost is $55 per person. Each person has cash. It's an all-day event, so it'll be 9, probably about 5:30, 6 o'clock. By the time you go out to the range, it'll be your range time. I look forward, I'm going to be here in the morning just to say hi to everybody. I've already got mine, but we have right here enough doors on time. If you're not on the list and you would like to still come and do it, you're more than welcome. So we have about, looks like we had 35 people sign up. About 20, I believe, are going to be able to make this first one. If you do not make the first one, we're going to hold the second one sometime in May. So this isn't the end of this. So if you can't do it this time, we'll pull that one. We'll get another date out there. All right? Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. There are several other announcements in the back of your bulletin. Be sure that you review those and not during the sermon, but later. So now let's prepare our hearts for worship as we listen to the prayer and the lighting of the campus. Thank you.
and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We'll continue with the opening hymn.
Thank you.
kingdom has broken into our troubled world through the life, death, and resurrection of your Son. Help us to hear your word and obey it, and bring your saving love to fruition in our lives through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
first reading is from Isaiah. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you that have no mercy, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you, because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way, and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord, that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are our ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Read the psalm responsibly. O God, you are my God. Eagerly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water.
Therefore I have gazed upon you in your holy place, that I may behold the power and your glory.
For your steadfast love is better than life itself. My lips shall give you praise.
So I bless you as long as I live, and lift up my hands to your name.
My spirit is content, as with the richest of foods, and my mouth praises you with joyful lips.
When I remember you upon my bed, I meditate on you in my watch.
For you have been my helper, and under the shadow of your wings I will rejoice.
I will be pleased to you, your right hand holds you fast.
Second reading is from 1 Corinthians. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and all ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink. But they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them, and they were struck down in the wilderness. Now these things occurred as examples for us, so that we might not desire evil as they did. Do not become idolaters, as some of them did, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink, and they rose up to play. We must not indulge in sexual immorality, as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in a single day. We must not put Christ to the test, as some of them did, and were destroyed by serpents. And do not complain as some of them did, and were destroyed by the destroyer. These things happened to them to serve as an example, and they were written down to instruct us on whom the ends of the ages have come. So if you think you are standing, watch out that you do not fall. No testing has overtaken you that is not common to everyone. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tested beyond your strength. But with the testing, he will also provide the way out so that you may be able to endure it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to Luke, the 13th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
At that very time, time there were some present who told him about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. Jesus asked them, "You think that because these Galileans suffered in this way, they were worse sinners than all other Galileans? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish as they did. Or those 18 on whom who were killed when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, you think they were worse offenders than all others living in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish just as they did." Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard. He came looking for fruit on it and found none. So he said to the gardener, "See here, for 3 years I have come looking for fruit on this fig tree, and still I find none. Cut it down. Why should it be wasting the soil?" He replied, "Sir, let it alone for one more year until I dig around it and put manure on it. If it bears fruit the next year, very well and good. But if not, you can cut it down." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. It was well known to Pilate that the region of the Galilee was a hotbed of anti-Roman activity and a haven of what the Romans would call terrorists and the Jews would call freedom fighters. But it is difficult to say whether the story of atrocity relating to Jesus that day was a fact or a rumor. Further, we are not told why those who came even told Jesus of the event. Whatever their motive, what seems clear is they looked for Jesus to denounce the Romans. Brutality and an act that if it happened, it would be unthinkable. And to denounce the defilement of Israel's most sacred place, the temple. If the report is true, then something like this must have happened. Some Galileans came to Jerusalem to offer sacrifices at the temple. And Pilate, thinking they were somehow tied into the revolutionary movement, offered his own sacrifice. He ordered his soldiers into the inner court, defiling the holy place, and at the massive 22-foot-high altar that sat right in front of the temple entrance. The Galileans were slain, and their blood mingled with that of their own offerings. Such an event would have instantly sent shockwaves throughout all of Israel, for Jesus not to denounce and renounce the Romans in the strongest possible language would be something akin to President Bush following immediately after 9/11, that if he had not condemned in the strongest language the death of 3,000 of our fellow citizens as the World Trade Center, both of them, had crumbled to the ground. You see, that would be absolutely unthinkable for a president not to come forward and denounce that, to speak on behalf of the nation in our grief. And what if the president in his television address to the nation would have said, "You think those 3,000 Americans who suffered in this way were worse sinners than all other Americans? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish as they did." No, we expect the president to denounce the deaths of our fellow citizens, and to go after those bad guys. I think that's what the people wanted and expected to hear from Jesus. They wanted Jesus as a rabbi to call down the wrath of God on their enemies. Of course, in Jesus' case, if he does not denounce such atrocity, then the people's affections will almost instantly begin to turn against him. On the other hand, if he does speak ill against Rome, then his detractors can level the charge of sedition against Jesus. Jesus does not denounce. Instead, he calls his own people to repentance. One commentator remarked that when he shared this story with some Middle Eastern peasants, they were surprised that the crowd didn't immediately take Jesus out and kill him. Well, remember, that was sort of the response in his hometown of Galilee, wasn't it? When he told them that the gospel wasn't first of all going to be preached to them, but, you know, that he had said, "Doubtless you will tell me, back to me this little proverb, you know, physician, heal yourself. What you did inside the entire do here, You know, what you did out there, do here. They expected this. Jesus was a son of their little village, and he was a rabbi, and he had power to heal, that he would do all those miracles for them first, their village first. And when Jesus said, no, it's not going to be that way, they gave him the bum's rush, rushing onto the edge of the hill upon which their little village was built. Remember, they wanted to throw him off, down in the rock pile and kill him. And Jesus, though, I don't, that would have been something to see. He just walked right through the midst of them and went on his way. But that's what these peasants said could have happened to Jesus that very day when he didn't denounce what the Romans had done. It's an amazing thing. Jesus has not come into the world, you see, to defeat the Romans, or even to reestablish Israel's golden age under King David and Solomon. Jesus has come as the shepherd of Israel to find the lost sheep, the house of Israel, and to bring them back to the fold. That is, Jesus has come to redeem the lost, make atonement. What is atonement? It's making one again, that which is not one, through his death and resurrection. To heal the relationship, reconciling human beings back to God. It is a mission of cosmic dimension and carries with it eternal consequences. I mean, think of it this way. See, Jesus did use his power. And they rallied people, got an army together, threw out the Romans. Well, so what? What do you think Rome's response to that would be? They had the 10th Legion stationed there. If you got 10 legions, the 10th Legion, isn't there like 1 through 9 someplace? I believe there is. Wouldn't they have just fought 1, 2, 5, 8, whatever it took, and go back and crush them? Yes. And so 2,000 years later, had they done that, you wouldn't be sitting here, literally. There'd be no church. There'd be really no Western society, because Western society was really built on the foundation of Christendom, of the Christian ethic about who God is. Because if God is knowable, if God is rational, then you can do science, you can think about creation, you can think about your world. And it was spawned out of Christian belief. That was the underpinning that set people free, and then how to be enlightenment. If it wasn't for Judeo-Christian ethic and thought process, there would be no Western civilization today. The whole world would be completely different. And Jesus came in that day and done what the people wanted him to do. But he didn't do that because that was not the mission the Father had sent him for. And remember, Jesus already argued that at the south in the wilderness, that Satan tempted him for 40 days. How are you going to use your power? Are you going to do the Father's will, or shall I do it smart, my way? Should I do my will? And Jesus came back and said, ultimately, no, Father, your will be done, not my will. He said it again in the Garden of Gethsemane, didn't he? He begged his Father that this cup should pass from him, that he shouldn't have to die this dastardly, terrible, evil death. He knew he had 12 legions of his Father's angels at his disposal. One word, it all been over. No contest whatsoever. Remember the book of Revelation, one mighty angel throws Satan into the lake of fire. One! There's no big contest, no big war. One grabs him, throws him down, and he's done. 12 legions. I think that's overkill. And yet Jesus there, sweating droplets so big it could have been blood, sweating blood. And the Garden of Gethsemane said, Father, not my will, but your will be done if this cup cannot pass from me. Jesus, all through his life, had to come back to the touchstone of saying he needed his Father's will to be done, not his own. So much so that he told the disciples, look, the things I speak to you are not just my words. These are things I hear from my Father, so I give you my Father's word. Now, my Father and I are one, so it's my word, but it's really my Father's word that I'm sharing with you. I didn't dream this stuff up. That's what he's saying. I didn't dream any of this stuff up. It's what my Father in heaven has given me to share with you. And that's what Jesus did over and over and over again in his teaching and his being with the people. And he would say, look, if you don't believe my words, then believe the deeds I'm doing. The dead are being raised. The blind are giving their sight. The lame are leaping up and walking. devils and demons are being cast out of people. If you won't believe my word, at least believe because you see the fruit of my ministry. You see the fruit of my life. Nobody can do this if God is not with them. And nobody can forgive sins if they're not God. And Jesus reminded them over and over that he had the power to forgive sin. Remember, he told Philip at the end in John 14, in my father's house, and mansions after that whole thing. And Thomas says, well, we don't know where you're going. He said, I'm the way, the truth, the life. Nobody comes to me except through the Father, or by me through the Father. And then Philip says, well, just show us the Father and we'll be happy. This has got to be one of the saddest things I can think of in the whole gospel. Jesus looks at Philip and he says, Philip, have I been with you all this time, 3 years, and yet you do not know me? Don't you understand yet that if you've seen me, you have seen the Father? And it's not written, but I think Philip would say, no, I haven't gotten that yet. I don't get it at all. I don't see how that can be. And they really didn't get it to win Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came and confirmed to them that everything Jesus had said was true. And then it was like the pieces began to be put together in all that puzzle. And it began to make sense to them. And then they were ready to go out and give their lives, as most of them did, as martyrs for sharing the gospel with all those to whom the Lord had sent them. It's an amazing kind of, you say, is the resurrection real? Is the gospel real? What people would hide and then somehow go preach and give their lives for something that people are really killing for? When you just say, well, this didn't work out. Well, they go, well, they tried. Went back fishing. Jesus showed up. Changed their mind. Think of that. No one goes off to give their life for something they don't absolutely believe in. The disciples did that very thing. So Jesus did not come to do anything else but be the good shepherd who came for the lost sheep, the house of Israel. And then, you know, he continued his point when he talked about another tragedy, not just the tragedy of those who had died in Pilate's hands, but the 18 upon whom the Tower of Siloam fell, killing them. If the people saw that those who were allegedly killed by Pilate in the temple, they saw them as innocent victims, then those who were killed by the tower were not innocent, but instead they were employees of the Roman government, Pilate. Remember, Pilate asked and received money from the temple treasury to build an aqueduct to supply water to Jerusalem. And while using surplus funds from the temple treasury was allowable, if they had enough money, you could do that under Jewish law. And they gave, the Jewish hierarchy gave Pilate the ability to use some of that money. But on the street, they thought it was theft, piracy. He'd come in the temple and he stole money to do this Roman project. Now, it was for them. They kind of forgot about that. But they hated Pilate for that. And they saw those who worked for him as lackeys of Rome. And so if the tower fell on them, then it was God's will. They reaped what they had sown. They got what they deserved. But Jesus treats the 18 as he does those upon whom Pilate fell, sending these soldiers in the temple to kill them, mingling their blood apparently with their sacrifices. It's a gutsy move by Jesus because he delves underneath the surface issue of whose side is God's God on. I mean, if you have a God, you think you want him, I want him to be on my side, not somebody else's side. So Jesus delves underneath that. And the parallel question of what can we expect God to do for us? In both instances, Jesus saw the event as a call to the people for repentance. A call from self-interest, from categorizing people, from judging the hearts and intents of others, to turning of their own heart back toward God. I mean, one of the things Jesus is trying to tell us is we're all in the same boat. When I was in Montana, Pastor Howard Marsh told this story. I don't remember everything he said, but this one I remember. He said, it's sort of like we're all in the same boat. It's sort of like you're on a sailing ship. and the boat's painting on water, and there's rats on the ship, and the rats on the deck look down into the cargo hold and see these rats down there swimming for their lives, and they're giving them raspberries for being so stupid for hanging out in the cargo hold instead of being up on the deck with them. And here's the deal. They don't understand the whole boat is going down. The whole boat is sinking. They're all in the same boat together, except the ones on the deck don't yet know that they're in the same predicament. The rats all share a common fate. Paul, in the second chapter of Romans, says it this way: "You therefore have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone else. For whatever point you judge the other, you are condemning yourself, because you who pass judgment do the very same things." Simply put, we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We're all in the same boat. And this reality distorts every other perception we live with and use as our guide. There's no way out of the maze that we're in. No way to extricate ourselves from brokenness or to make ourselves whole. You can't do it. If you've broken a relationship, you don't have the power to heal it again. You can't do it. Even between human beings, it takes somebody forgiving you and bearing what you've done in the second time to say, "Yes, you hurt me. Yes, you're a jerk, but I won't allow you to be a jerk to destroy our relationship." And they bear them and they say, "I forgive you." That's beyond us. And there's no use of putting others down as a way of pushing ourselves up. We're all in it together. And apart from Christ, we all will perish together. The only way out of the maze is to retrace our steps back to the one from whom we're trying so hard to escape from. The only way out is to come home, to repent, to turn around, to come back toward God. In the end, it is really to allow God to be God. Because what we're all trying to do is put ourselves on the throne of our heart, be our own God, say what's right, what's wrong, what's good for me. You can have your thing, I got my thing, thank you very much. We'll just part friends and let live, and we'll go on our way. No. You got to take yourself off the throne of your heart and put God back on the throne of your heart. That's where he belongs. That's what he created us for, to be in relationship with him. So allowing God to be God is allowed to have the rightful place in your life that he always meant to have by your very creation. But the one thing we must do, you see, to repent, we can't even do that on our own. And so Jesus tells the people the parable of the fig tree and of the owner who waits 3 years for the fig tree to mature. Then he waits for another 3 years as the fruit was considered forbidden, according to Leviticus 19:23. So now we're into this 6 years. The fruit of the fourth year, that is the seventh year of the tree's life, was considered clean and was offered to the Lord. This is the fruit which the owner comes seeking, the seventh year fruit which belongs to the Lord. But this is now the third year of seeking the Lord's portion, and yet no fruit is to be found. The situation appears utterly hopeless. So the owner commands the vine dresser or the gardener to dig it out by the roots. "Why should it be using up the ground?" But the vine dresser replies, "Master, forgive it this year also until I dig around it and spread on manure. And if it bears in the future, so be it. But if not, dig it out." Jesus' parable is pointed against the unfruitful Jewish leadership. In this instance, they are the barren fig tree in the midst of the vineyard of Israel. But what Jesus says about them really applies to us all, because the main characters in this parable are judgment and mercy. That's the two main characters, justice and mercy. The point of the parable is all are given the opportunity to bear fruit, even the most unproductive. No one knows the limits of God's patience. But for now, we live in a moment of God's grace, a moment of God's utter mercy toward us. And we are recipients of God's horticultural care and nurture. We are afforded every opportunity to repent and to experience forgiveness, which comes to us in and through our Lord Jesus. Some are afraid to repent, to come back close to God. But really, when you think about it, who takes all the risks? God has taken all the risks, not us. We don't take any risk at all. God takes the risk.
In Jesus, God risked our rejection of his love. And our Lord, God sought us out. And through the broken body of his Son, God calls us to wholeness and to peace, to forgiveness and to new life. For in Jesus, the warfare between God and human beings has come to an end. And God, the vine dresser, honors our free will. He honors our free will by awaiting our response.
Others from seeking you. Lord, in your mercy.
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, be with us each step of the way in our journey with you to the cross. Give us moments of silence throughout each day that we may push aside all that consumes us in this earthly life, so that we may reflect on what should be the most important things in our lives. The awareness that you suffered and died for us who are most unworthy, and that you arose again to save our sick souls. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, thank you for allowing us to experience another season of spring with all the newness and beauty of an awakening life in your creation. Keep us ever mindful of the rebirth of our lives in you when our old selves die and we are renewed in Christ Jesus through the waters of holy baptism. We pray this season of spring and the changes we observe in nature will serve as a reminder of our Savior's sacrifice on the cross and his glorious victory over sin and death. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, tomorrow has been set aside to commemorate the Annunciation of our Lord, when the angel Gabriel appeared to Mary, the mother of our Lord Jesus. Father, in Mary, you have given us another example of what it means to be your humble servant. Mary could not have known nor understood all that you asked of her. By the intercession of your Holy Spirit, she was able to praise you and accept your plan for her life. Even though in this earthly life her suffering would be profound, how blessed and honored she was to be chosen as the mother of our Lord. Grant us the grace to follow her example of humility and acceptance of God's will. Let her prayer be our prayer. I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said. Lord, in your mercy. Spirit of God, in this season of fasting and denial, redirect our thoughts and desires to establishing a closer relationship with our Lord. Help us to repent of our sins and to acknowledge a need for change within ourselves. A change will move us toward doing God's will and away from our sinful, sorrowful selves. We offer our most humble thanks to our Father, who in spite of all of our failings still calls us to himself and still loves us more than we ever know. Lord, in your mercy. Compassionate Lord, we offer our prayers for those among us who are so very much in need of your presence in their lives, those who are suffering from mental or physical pain and despair, those who are alone or who are lonely and forgotten, those who are hungry that they may be fed, those who are naked and need to be clothed, those who are homeless and need to be sheltered, those who are sick and those who are dying. We commend to your care the members of our church community who are suffering the loss of a loved one, those on our prayer chain, those who are homebound, and those who are named in our bulletin. Be with us your faithful service and with all for whom we offer now our silent prayer. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we come and all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
I'd like to share Christ's own peace. One with another.
Thank you.
Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who gave your Son both as a sacrifice for sin and a model of a godly life, enable us to receive him always with thanksgiving and to conform our lives to his, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Love and trust in the Lord.
Thanks be to God.